Welcome back. In this video, let's go over custom structural trusses. So this is actually a big topic, and I will be focusing on creating a simple custom truss. Let's first take a look at opening what we have in the content library of Revit. So if you go to the structural trusses, look at the Fink trusses, or look at the Houghflat truss, or the gable truss, or the scissors truss. You'll see different variations of that. I'm going to open the 8-panel scissor truss to show you what's in there. Let's go to visibility graphics, turn on all the hidden items in there. You'll see it has overall truss length. And then we have equal to indicate where the midpoint is. And then you have these reference planes that kind of subdivide the truss into these 8 panels. So it would be easy to manipulate this, like doing save as and but you kind of have to make sure you don't delete the main parameters for the length and for the height of the truss. Can I maintain that? Okay, so that's very important. So if you want to do that, you need to do like a save as. Make sure you give it a unique name so you don't get confused which one is which. So this is one of my favorite trusses. I actually have it in my house. Looks pretty good. Give you these vaulted ceilings. Now let's take a look at the Houghflat truss. The Houghflat truss is really the most versatile of all the trusses that come with Revit, and we're going to do a save as and give it a new name. And take a look at what is hidden in this view. What you will find out is that there is a lot of hidden stuff in here that are kind of unusual, and they are different than the scissor truss that we looked at earlier. So as you can see, of course we have the length, we have the height that's given, but there's like these groups that make up those panels of these diagonal webs, right? So each of those trusses is made up of a top chord, bottom chord, and diagonal webs. And it's hard to explain why Autodesk would want to make those trusses in this way, but this truss is probably the smartest truss that we have in the content library. And if you edit one of those groups, you'll see it has two diagonal webs. It's got a dimension the top of the diagonal web to the top chord, and it's got truss height and the actual panel width. So that's how it's controlled. I just find this a little bit cumbersome, you know, for me to do the exact same thing with my custom truss. That's probably that comes only in one size. Just, you know, maybe too much work. So what we're going to do is we're going to use the brand new template of the structural trusses, right? So it's we used not the open command, but the new truss command, okay? New family. In this family template, we're going to go ahead and create some divisions, right? So we'll assume certain number of divisions for this new truss, right? So I'm going to create some reference planes, and for your information, this video has not been edited very much. What you see is what you get. This is actually what happened when I was recording this video, and I made a lot of mistakes, and I decided to keep those mistakes in there because I think they're very educational. and they'll show you what could happen if you rush through things and not have everything parametric. So so I'm creating these vertical reference planes. I'm going to, you know, mirror them to the other side. And of course, I'm delete the dimensions and extend the equal dimensions to all the reference planes. That's the first thing we'll do. The second thing we'll do is we'll add these top chords and bottom chords. The top chords and bottom chords go all the way from the left to the right. They don't stop in the middle. Okay, so using the create command, you can do that. Now, that's the easy part. The tough part is to add the diagonal webs. So first, or the vertical webs. First, we'll start with the vertical webs and make sure that every time we add a vertical web, we're going to go ahead and lock those vertical webs to the reference plane. It's not a good idea to go to create the entire truss and then go to a project and test it. It's guaranteed to fail. There's no way you're gonna make it work. There's too many variables here, okay? So I'm making sure all the vertical webs are aligned with the reference planes in order to have a valid truss. So the last truss I made was called truss number 4. We'll call this one truss number 5. And we will create a new project, and we'll use a structural template for that. And simply using the truss command, we can just draw a truss. We're using the half-flat truss, which comes standard with the structural template. Okay. Initially, I'm going to set the length to be 48 feet. I'm not really sure why I did that, although the template it comes with 80 feet, but you have to start somewhere. So I'm going to hide those levels and turn this around. So we're looking at this truss. Now the members of the truss are white flange steel beams, but you know, don't worry about it. We'll fix that later. So this could be a light gauge metal framing or wood framing eventually, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to load the custom truss on the right hand side into the project for testing purposes. This is not finished yet, okay? So Don't freak out yet, we're still testing. So we're going to replace the existing truss with truss number 5, and obviously it failed. So I'm going to go back and look at the family and fix it. So it helps to have the project and the family side by side. And sometimes you don't know where the problem is until you delete it and do another member. I'm checking now the alignment and the locks between the reference planes and the vertical webs. And to my surprise, that was not a very good approach. I use a different technique. You'll see it in a moment. All right. So back to the project. I'm changing the truss height to 20 feet, from 10 feet to 20 feet. I'm gonna switch back to the half flat truss, and then I'm going to. Go go back and do some work on the family. So the dilemma now is that where is the problem, right? We don't know what the problem is. Okay, the truss length is 80 feet, right? So I just noticed that. So I'm going to change that to 40 feet to see what the problem is. And as you can see, we can start to see where the failed members are. Again, I left a lot of these glitches and hiccups in the video so that you'll be able to see how I was able to troubleshoot those instances where I had some problems. So I deleted, the best way to deal with the problem in Revit is to delete the problem, not try to fix it. So I'm deleting those items that have issues, and then I'm going to check to see the number of verticals, and because we're changing the truss length, it's causing issues with duplicate elements, right? So now changing the truss back to 80 feet shows me some gaps in there, so that allows me to go back and put those in place. It's not clear exactly why this happened, right? But you know, it could be missing one lock, one alignment, and then that throws off the entire truss. All right, so I'm putting back the reference planes, and I'm going to strike a dimension from the left hand side and catch every single reference plane. Make sure everything's equal. Okay, one more time. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to check for duplicate vertical cords. Add the missing ones, of course. Lock the locks with the alignment. And keep saving frequently so that just in case someone pull the plug, you don't know you have saved in the past few minutes, because you're not going to remember exactly what happened. So I changed the truss length to 40 feet, and as you can see, it's working without errors. So that's very encouraging. That means we can proceed with that. Okay. Let's load that into the project and change the truss type from the half flat truss to the truss number 5. Okay, so we still have some issues because of the truss length. So one of the things I noticed that when you do a custom truss yourself, you may want to set the truss length and kind of keep it that way. You don't want to mess with it too much because of the repetition. You know, it could mean that the Revit needs a little bit more TLC, tenderness, love, and care in order for it to take care of the length and height for you, as well as all the alignment of the webs. All right, so we're back to 80 feet. And we're going to see what happens if we change the truss height. Does that stay? Yeah, so it looks like it's working. Okay, so it looks like we have an 80-foot truss with a top cord, bottom cord, and the vertical webs. And it looks like it's fine. It's just that when you change the length, it's when you get the duplicate elements. Although it shouldn't be that way, okay? So I think what I'm going to do, you can see that there are double elements in there. I'm going to go back to the original family and see if I can clean it up a little bit. Yeah, so be patient because this is a little bit longer video than I like it to be, but I'm checking. I'm doing a using the selection method with my mouse and then doing a spot check for the selection filter to make sure I don't have duplicate elements there. It looks like I do have some, so what I'm going to do is delete anything that is not supposed to be there. All this work, mind you, this is happening before we put the diagonal webs. Diagonal webs is a whole different ball game and poses new challenges on us. Okay, so it looks like for some reason I have duplicate reference planes or duplicate elements in that location. So I'm going to try to clean it up. Again, you can see I'm having a little bit of a challenge there. So if you want to see the diagonal web, you can fast forward through this video to the diagonal web, but it's probably a good idea to see every failure in order to learn what could go wrong. Now, I'm sure, you know, someone who is expert at trusses could probably do this better than me, but again, this is an attempt to you know, go out of the box and do something that is a little bit different than what we already have in the Revit content library. Now, I want to say just a quick word that this would not matter very much if the truss manufacturer is manufacturing those trusses and trusses are hidden inside the gable or hip roof. Why does it matter? You know, how do you divide the trusses? That's totally a structural issue that should not be of a concern. However, what I'm trying to show here is that if you were to use those trusses as a feature in your project and have them exposed trusses, then the configuration of the truss itself would make a difference. Okay? So I'm going to settle to 80 feet again, and you can see that we don't get any more error messages. And once we get to that point, we're ready to do the diagonal webs. All right, diagonal web. First attempt was actually pretty good. We were able to create the first two and test the height and see that it actually works very well. Issues don't start to happen until you get to the third one for some reason. And it has to do with snapping, it has to do with multiple references, reference planes, and other vertical webs. Alright, so as soon as I put the third one, I got a problem. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to undo the changes in the project, go back to the family, fix that in the family, and load that in the project. And I do that very, very frequently, as frequent as I can, in order to avoid the problem. So the technique is to use the align command and use the reference plane and then use the tab key to grab the point at the end of the diagonal web. Now, what I found the hard way is that you essentially need to lock everything. You can't just leave that up for chances. Now, if you lock it's the same item multiple times, you will get an error message. So it's kind of foolproof. So lock everything, and then when Revit gives you error message, stop. All right. So the second attempt at creating those diagonal webs looks like it's working. Okay, for these particular ones, and I'm going to attempt to copy those to the other side instead of sketching them from scratch. But that's going to create, of course, a host of all kinds of problems for me. But as I said before, the solution is to make sure that you lock them in place. So here we go. You can see that almost all of them failed. The first one, the third one, and the last one, and the fourth one. So back to the drawing board. Now we're going to start locking those elements that we know are just flying away, right? So command is align, click on the reference plane, use the tab key to grab the point, and lock it. You see in multiple instances like this one where it was already locked, but I tried to lock it and Revit would give me a message saying you can't, this would over constrain your model. And this is going to happen a lot because I'm going to make sure that all the T's are crossed, all the I's are dotted, and learn the hard way, because it took some time to get to this point. So I can't afford to let anything slip by, right? So it's better to be safe than sorry in this case. Of course, this is not a crazy truss. I'm sure you can use the same technique to create something a little bit more creative than this, but the idea is that you can just get out of the box and create something that is a little bit more creative than what you already have in the project. There's a lot of aligning, unlocking, and doing this over and over again, and testing. So we know the vertical webs are working. No need to mess with those, hopefully. So it's a diagonal web that needs to be adjusted. We're getting to the close to the end of this. I'm simply going to save the family, new family template, load in the project, and then update the truss in the project. Okay, so you can tell that the last two on the top has some issues, right? So I'll undo that, go back, I know exactly where the problem is, and try to fix it right there. This is where you know, I'm looking at it, and I'm like, I'm pretty sure there's something wrong with it. Okay, here we go. You always want to override the element and its parameter values. And it looks, I think the solution was to align it with the vertical reference plane, not the horizontal one. Aha, see? Okay, so that was the missing part. So sometimes it's hard to tell whether it's the horizontal reference plane, whether it's a vertical reference plane, that should work. Okay, so, the funny thing about Revit is that sometimes it doesn't give you the problem, the error message or the result the way you want it until later, until you fix one of them, then the second one gets fails. This is the fun part where you're getting so close to the end of this, and you know it's gonna work, but Revit still gives you a hard time. Okay, yay! So this is working. So we have a truss in the project. We can change the truss height from 20 feet to 10 feet, and change it back to whatever, 40 feet, 30 feet, and then eventually you're gonna see that it's actually working very well. Now, what I didn't have much luck with the length of the truss as much as I had luck with the height of the truss. So what you want to do is you really want to take it easy and try not to do everything at the same time, and bite a big bite that you can't chew. So saving on a regular basis, do a save as, and keep different versions of this. Okay, the final part of this video is going over loading a structural framing member either in light gauge mother framing or in wood dimensional lumber. And in this case, I'm going to load 2x6 and 2x10. That will act as the vertical and horizontal members of the truss. Simply edit the type. Make a duplicate, give it a name, and set the framing type for the top chord, bottom chords, vertical web, and the diagonal web. And that's it. So obviously this is a structural template, so you may want to turn on your shaded view and turn off your analytical lines and so on and so forth. Hope you enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching and subscribing to my channel. Take care.